Hey, it's John at Enduring Charm. You know, running a YouTube channel can be enlightening about human nature. This old radial arm saw is still in my shop. And back in 2013, sometime during that period, almost 10 years ago now, I made a video about radial arm saws and whether they really have a place in a modern shop. And essentially my conclusion was they really don't. It's something that if you like old machinery, you might have just as more of entertainment more than anything else. But in a modern shop, I don't really think they have a place. So I have gotten more comments about that video. To this day, I'm still getting comments about that video. Some of them are quite nasty, honestly, you know, basically accusing me of eating puppies and taking candy from children. So in this video, I just want to go over some details about the radial arm saw that have come up over the years in those comments. So look, I'm a fan of old machinery too, and if this is something you just enjoy having in your shop because it's fun to look back on the old ways of doing things, that's great. More power to you. So back in the day, in the 60s and the 70s, the radial arm saw was sold as a tool that could do everything. You could do cross-cutting on it, you could do ripping on it, you could do rudimentary forms of routing on it, and it was popular for that reason. It was a one tool that you could do a lot of things for. But a jack of all trades is also known as a master of none, and that is definitely a problem with this type of saw. Now briefly, if you've never seen one of these saws before, it has a motor here mounted, the saw blade is here, and it moves on an arm. There's some ball bearings in there, and the arm itself can be adjusted back and forth to get different angles for cross-cutting. And the other thing is for ripping, you can, I'll show you this, you can move this entire head, you know, 90 degrees. You can also make adjustments for the angle down here. So it's one of those things where you can adjust it many different ways to do what you're trying to do. Now, one of the comments I got a lot on that old video was that I had the wrong blade mounted in the saw. And what they're referring to is there's a climb cut associated with this type of saw, meaning there's a handle right here, and as you pull the saw towards you to make a cross cut, whether it's a 90 degree cross cut or at an angle, the saw blade has a tendency to climb up the workpiece. And if you use a negative rake saw blade, then that will minimize that. And that's true. And I don't have a negative rake saw blade mounted in here because I rarely use it. And when I do use it, it's just for rough cutting something. So I didn't have that mounted on here. And that was something that people called me out on. There's some truth to that, but not that big a deal, I don't think. The primary thing I got in the comments, though, was about ripping. In that old video, I just happened to point to the saw when I was talking about ripping in one direction. And boy, I still get comments 10 years later that I was pointing in the wrong direction and that's not how you rip. Well, that's not entirely true. Now let me show you in this video how you do set up for ripping, and then we'll talk about some specifics here. So for this saw, and it may be different on some of the other saws, but for this old Craftsman, there's a locking mechanism right here. So I unlock it by pulling it in that direction. And then over here, there's a locking pin, I'll call it, and I can lift that up. This is a little sticky because it's old. If I lift that pin up, then I can turn this head in a 90 degree orientation. So if I grab the handle here, I'll lift up that locking pin. And I can turn it this direction and make it at a 90. Or I could turn it the other direction and make it at a 90. So the locking pin will lock in there. And then if I lift it up again, it's a little sticky. I'll go this direction just to show you. So there's two different directions you could rip. And notice right on the saw itself, there's a scale and it says in rip or out rip. Those are two different directions you could rip at. Now I'll show you some excerpts here of some manuals. And if you look at these manuals, there's a Craftsman manual that mentions in ripping and out ripping. There is a, this is a DeWalt manual that mentions in ripping and out ripping. And there is a Delta manual here that mentions in ripping and out ripping. Now in ripping would be feeding the workpiece from the right, and outripping would be feeding the workpiece from the left. Now, the reason this is even mentioned and why I got a whole bunch of comments about this is, again, because of that climb cut. And depending on how you have this head oriented and which direction you're feeding the workpiece, you could have a situation where the workpiece will basically shoot out. Now, forget for a moment which direction I have it facing. It really doesn't matter for this particular discussion. The teeth of the saw blade are coming down like this, and when it turns, it comes down like this, right? It's turning in a clockwise direction. So just for the sake of argument, if I fed a workpiece in this direction, what's going to happen? Those teeth are going to want to grab that workpiece and shoot it out, okay? And that's your climb cut. If I fed it from the opposite side, I'd be going against that action, and it would be a little more stable. But there is an infeed and an outfeed direction, and I'm not sure everybody understands that. I think most of these radial arm saws, I haven't looked at every single model, but most of them, the head can turn either direction. So you could have it facing the direction you see here or the opposite direction. So for the people who made the comments that there's only one direction to rip, well, you're flat out wrong. I mean, there are two directions here right on the scale. I showed you the manuals. These were sold and described as ripping in either direction, okay? Where you have that head oriented is important, it is true, but there are two directions you might rip at. All right, the feed direction aside, let's talk about ripping in general. Now, a lot of times in these comments, I'm accused of not knowing what I'm doing, I don't have experience, and I'm saying the wrong thing. Well, I have 17 years of professional experience and 10 years of amateur experience beyond that. So I think I have enough experience to make a judgment here. And my judgment is that these radial arm saws are not anywhere near as safe for ripping as a table saw. Now let me go into some details about that. Now we already talked about the tendency for the blade of a radial arm saw to climb the workpiece. And you can minimize that by the direction that you feed, but it has that tendency. A table saw, by contrast, the blade is spinning in this direction here, and it wants to push the workpiece down. So it's safer in that sense. Now, another thing to talk about as far as safety is the size of the workpiece. With a radial arm saw, you have two problems. One is a workpiece that's too small, and the other is a workpiece that's too big. Now, this head will slide back and forth, and that gives you your dimension here as far as how wide you can cut. But realize you're going to need some kind of infeed and outfeed table in order to feed that. And one problem is if you have big work pieces, let's say you have a 4x8 sheet of plywood, and let's make a 3/4 inch plywood, which is very heavy, you're going to have difficulty cutting that on a radial arm saw because you would need to prop it up here on some kind of infeed outfeed table. It's going to hang over quite a bit, and you're just going to have difficulty getting it up there and making a smooth cut. You're also going to be very limited by how much you can cut because this only goes so far. Now, a table saw, by contrast, has a lot more space here, first of all, so you can make a much wider cut, and it's inherently more stable as far as a piece of plywood, something that big, because you have a lot more surface area to work with. Now, I realize I'm fortunate to have a big table saw like this. A lot of people might be using a smaller table saw, maybe something like this. Well, even here, you have a much wider gap. This is 25 inches between the saw blade and the fence. And again, you have more surface area to work with to hold that plywood. You'll still need an outfeed table or a helper in order to do something big like a piece of plywood, but it's definitely more manageable than on a radial arm saw. Now, what about small work pieces and narrow cuts? Well, there's not a lot of room in here to fit a push stick or, you know, some kind of protection for your fingers. You're going to have to push that in there, and even if you use a push stick, at some point with a small workpiece like this, you're going to find your hands very close to the blade with not much protection. On a table saw, by contrast, you have a lot more options. You can use a push stick or a hold down, something like this, to move a small workpiece. In this case, the hold down will prevent the front end here from lifting up on you, and coming up at you. And you can use feather boards very easily because you have a groove already set up here. So a feather board can hold that workpiece against the fence. So it's definitely a lot safer, and there are ways to keep your fingers away from the problem. Now, most radial arm saws do have this feature, which is a hold down mechanism. All right, so this has a little floppy thing right here, and you're supposed to adjust this. There's a wing nut right here, so you adjust this so that it comes down on your workpiece, and it's a hold down to keep your workpiece from moving up on you. Now, another safety feature which is available on a table saw but not on a radial arm saw is a riving knife. What happens is, and this is very much true of modern day wood, you'll get what's called case hardening. And what happens is the wood is kiln dried, and sometimes kiln dried too fast, and you get internal stresses in that wood. And what happens is when you rip it, or cross cut it sometimes, but especially when you rip it, those internal stresses are released, and the wood will tend to blow apart or squeeze together. So a riving knife, and that's what this is here, keeps the workpiece from squeezing together so much that it pinches the saw blade. On our table saw, that's important because if the wood does pinch together, it can fly up at you. Now, on a radial arm saw, maybe the wood's not going to fly up at you, but it is going to prevent you from making the cut, because if it pinches a saw blade, it can pinch it enough to actually stop the cut. So there is no riving blade on a radial arm saw. I should also point out that the blade on a radial arm saw is always going to be pretty much at least half exposed like this, and sometimes more. On a table saw, by contrast, you can lower and raise that blade so that only a few teeth are sticking out from the top of the workpiece and the rest is hidden below the table. That's just not something you can do with a radial arm. Now, losing a finger is not the only way that a saw can be dangerous. So I want to mention some other things that are rarely brought up. Now, you notice on this particular radial arm saw, there is some rudimentary form of dust collection. So it has this kind of, you know, area right here to capture the dust, or to try to capture some of the dust. And then it has a little port right here, and you could hook up a vacuum or something to that, or dust collection system potentially. It's not very big, but it's something. So they made an attempt. However, I have to say, it's really not very effective. The sawdust comes out and it is ejected really below this. You can adjust this and twist it. In fact, I'll show you. There's a little, see this little thumb screw right here? So I can, it's a little stuck. I can adjust that to try to capture more of it. But look what happens when I do that. Now I'm capturing more dust, but I'm also exposing more blades. So this really has limited utility in my view. A lot of dust escapes from there. As a matter of fact, not just dust, but you know, pieces, chips can be ejected here and could be a danger to your eyes as well. Now, on a table saw, the dust is generally pushed down underneath. Some will escape, but most of it goes underneath. And then you can set up a dust collection system like I have here, and it's really quite effective. With that going, there's really not much dust that escapes. Now, on a smaller table saw like this, same thing. Now, it maybe isn't quite as effective, but there is a port in the back for dust collection, and it's definitely more effective than a radial arm saw. Another safety consideration that isn't mentioned very often is the noise level. And when you've been doing this as long as I have, your ears really take a beating. Tinnitus or tinnitus is really no joke. It really changes your life. So noise levels are definitely very important. And as far as shop tools like this, I have never measured any shop tool that's louder than a radial arm saw. Now, I'm sure some radial arm saws are louder than others. This particular one, though, has measured very high on the decibel scale. I've done tests before. And in relation to a table saw, it's just much louder. So that is going to damage your hearing more quickly if this is something you use very often. Now, if something goes wrong, what do? You reach for the power switch, right? Turn it off. In this particular case, now, some radial arm saws may be a little different, but in this particular case, there's a switch up top here. This is definitely not the original switch, but it's in the same location. And so if you need to turn this off in a hurry, you need at least one hand to be able to reach up here to get the switch. Now, modern table saws, by contrast, usually have some kind of way to stop the saw with your leg or your knee, maybe an arm, but usually you have some kind of quick stop like this, so that if you need to turn power off quickly, you can do it. Same thing on this smaller saw. You have the switch right here. When that's up, you could definitely hit that with your knee or your leg to pop it down. So turning a saw off quickly on a modern table saw is going to be much easier than trying to do it on an old radial arm saw. So look, I'm probably just muddying up the waters here, and I'll cause more comments on this video too, but the old video and the comments that I got on that, many of them mentioned the fact that they used a radial arm saw for 10 or 20 or 30 years or whatever, and they never lost a finger. Well, that's a type of logical fallacy, right? I mean, that's anecdotal evidence, and just because you didn't lose a finger personally doesn't mean that someone else couldn't, and also doesn't mean that this isn't a dangerous saw. Most people, I think, who have used the saw for a period of years will agree that it's more dangerous than some other options. And what I would hate to see is a young person drawn to this type of saw rather than a table saw, when in fact a modern table saw is safer on a lot of different levels. Now, if you enjoy vintage machinery and you just like the idea that you can do a lot of different things on this, even if it is more dangerous, well, that's fine. Go ahead and do it. But just be aware of the risks. I guess that's all I'm saying. So I hope the comments on this will be a little kinder. I really don't eat puppies and I don't take candy from children, but I do want to point out that the radial arm saw probably has passed its prime. And if you like to use old machinery, that's great. But for most people, this is just not going to be ideal for a modern shop.